tribe that lived here before Europeans came over, deciding to try to fulfill their manifest destiny. The Native Americans call this area Chicagua, which basically translates to land of the smelly onion. So when Europeans came over this way, they found it as a valuable shipping port, not necessarily for a waterway, which they were looking for something to go west, but they found a good place to put a railroad. So they started Chicago and incorporated it into a city in 1837. When they decided to settle here, they decided to build with the cheapest, most readily resource available to them, which was wood. So they clear-cut the woods of Michigan and Wisconsin to build the first incarnation of Chicago. And putting a railroad here is basically what built the city, because if you wanted to go anywhere using the railroads and come through Chicago, you had to stay overnight. That's how they decided, we're going to build our city that way. So they built hotels, they made restaurants, shopping, above-board activities, some below-board, and this would help grow the city. Now, it was not necessarily planned very well, and people grabbed their prime real estate and build. So things were a little bit ramshackle, for lack of a better word. And when they built it, everything was made of wood. Like, from the buildings to the sidewalks, the bridges, everything was made of wood. And people would say, you know, building everything in wood might not be the best idea, because if a little spark were to start anywhere, it might be a problem. And to be honest, if something did happen as bad as that, we could use a second chance to do this the right way. And if you believe in the secret, like Oprah does, and you throw it onto the universe and it becomes reality, which basically most people in this city will believe in when Oprah has to say.
She's pretty great.
Yeah, she is pretty great. Basically, they threw it out into the universe and it became reality in 1871. We had our Chicago fire. Hundreds upon hundreds of people were killed in the fire. 3.3 square miles demolished. And although it was a tragedy, people also saw it as an opportunity to build again, and that's what they decided to do. But this time, instead of building with wood again, they decided to build with steel and stone. And they raised up the city to accommodate the growing needs of a big city, and they started building with steel and stone, which attracted architects. That is the key to Chicago. Chicago would not be what it is today hadn't it been for the fire, because when architects started descending on the city, they started building beautiful architecture. The very first skyscraper in the world was built in Chicago. Cool little fun fact. That's also how we get our name, the Second City. I don't know if you've heard of the Second City, a training center and launch pad for people like Tina Fey or Chris Farley, John Belushi, if you go back to the beginnings. That's where we get our term, and they've kind of co-opted that. So we built this second city, and after the fire, we became the fastest growing city in the world. So much so that when it was coming to an opportunity to host the World's Fair in 1893, which would be anniversary of Columbus's expedition to the New World, plus a year, I'm going to be fashionably late, I guess, there was a competition between places to host it. New York, obviously, the big contender. Chicago decides to throw its hat in the ring. St. Louis does too, but St. Louis were like, thanks for your input. It was really, no offense to St. Louis, but it was really between Chicago and New York. And in this battle of words through investors and in the journals and in the papers of the day, New York was getting frustrated with Chicago because we were really talking up the city. They were calling us a city full of hot air, a real windy city. And you're experiencing the literal wind, but that is the literary wind. That's where we get our name, the Windy City. In this battle of words, Chicago prevails, and we end up getting to host the World's Fair, which we will call the Columbian Exposition. We decide to build a white city, basically a temporary city that would host millions upon millions of people over the course of several years. And what we wanted to do was outdo the World's Fair that was previous, which was in Paris when Eiffel built his famous tower. We wanted to out-Eiffel Eiffel. So we decided to find a guy by the name of William Ferris. And he built something uniquely Chicago. And what he built, and you could probably assume, is the Ferris wheel. I always find it's a funny story because Daniel Burnham, who was basically running the show in this World's Fair, gave William Ferris artistic license to do what he wanted to do. What he did was he took Pullman cars, which were train cars that were specifically in Chicago that were responsible for shipping meat products and everything across the country, the train yards being here. Pullman had basically a monopoly on the train industry in Chicago. He took the Pullman cars, and those were the cars for the first Ferris wheel. Over right behind us there is a Ferris wheel on Navy Pier, our city's biggest attraction. that Ferris wheel is about a third of the size of the one built for the World's Fair, because the Pullman cars pulled about 30 people.
But the thing is, he didn't know it was going to work, and to be honest, he needed a deadline, and that's what Burnham did. He gave him a deadline. After he had procrastinated a couple years, he said, you guys have to open tomorrow. So he got a bunch of people to work on this Ferris wheel and rivet the hell out of it the night before. And that crowd who was watching him work on the Ferris wheel became the line for the next morning. They stayed and they waited for this line. They opened the gates. They let him on. They should have tested it, maybe. They get these people on. They fill a few cars, and they pull the lever, and it's screeching and squealing and shaking and starts moving and bolts are falling off. But not because they're loose, because when they were riveting it, if a stray bolt shot off, they're like, forget it, we'll clean it later. They didn't. And with the bolts falling off and the people inside seeing bolts fall off, they were screaming. So it was all this chaos, but it held, and it ended up making up a lot of the revenue that had been lost prior to him not completing it. But I feel like that reputation of the Ferris wheel has stuck with it to this day. If you go to a carnival or something, you're like, oh, this looks a little janky. And the guy who's running it doesn't really care, you know. He's on meth. I don't know.